Penguin Random House Audio presents White Women, Everything You Already Know About Your Own Racism and How to Do Better. Written and read by Regina Jackson and Saira Rao. This is the author, Regina Jackson. For all Black, Indigenous, Brown, and non-white girls and women, and non-binary identifying folks who are sick and tired of white women's bullshit. With love and sisterhood, Regina and Saira. For my family and extended family, my late mother and father, my husband, my children and grandchildren, my 12 siblings, nieces, nephews, and their children. As long as the spirit of a warrior lives in the heart of just one of us, the dance is not over. African proverb, with love, Regina.
For my late mother, Greenie, my second mother, Bodge, my mother-in-law, Uji, my sister, Tooth, my daughter, LG, my father, Pinata, my husband, Beagle, and my son, DG. With love, Saira.
What is Race to Dinner? Race to Dinner was founded in 2019 as a dinner experience with myself, Regina Jackson, a Black woman, and Saira Rao, an Asian woman, with 8 to 10 white women. There is no better place for honest conversations than at the dinner table. Breaking bread together helps to facilitate conversations around white supremacy, racism, and xenophobia. These dinners require white women to participate in direct, difficult conversation. It is not for the faint of heart. It is not racism 101. It is tough, vulnerable, and full of emotion. So too this book. Welcome. Preface. If you're listening to this, you are most likely white. Most of what's here, you already know. You've known it your whole life. After all, it's you, white people, who created white supremacy, who benefit from white supremacy, who uphold white supremacy. A critical component of upholding white supremacy is employing a feigned ignorance that brings you here to these pages, asking a Black woman and a Brown woman to explain to you the nuances of this script, a script you wrote, directed, and produced, and from which you've amassed dizzying wealth and power. A critical component of our work is radical honesty. On our part, sure, but more crucially, on yours. Why do we bother? After all, this country was founded on the genocide of indigenous people, the enslavement and genocide of African people. Since the beginning, it has been racism, xenophobia, violence, rinse, repeat. The Chinese Exclusion Act, Japanese internment, Operation Wetback, Jim Crow, police brutality, ICE concentration camps, Muslim bans, the disastrous impacts of COVID-19. All orchestrated by white people. You know what you're doing, but you pretend not to. You've pretended for so long, decades, centuries, that some of you have managed to convince yourselves that you're immune to white supremacy, that you've been vaccinated by goodness. You believe you're colorblind. Most of you have surrounded yourselves with other white people who share your feigned ignorance. You may have the errant person of color in your friend group. Usually, that person buttresses your charade. People of color uphold white supremacy every single day. It's called being a token. We are intimately familiar with this role. Even the term people of color is a product of white supremacy. Consider why White people are not considered people of color when your skin has a color just like ours. I retired from the Bell system in 1998 after nearly 30 years of service. My position at retirement was executive director of large business and government sales and service, reporting directly to the general manager. How did I rise to that level and accomplish those career achievements? I knew how to code switch. I knew how to carry myself and how to not be a threat to white people. I was a token. So too was Saira, the token brown friend to countless white women. She allowed these white women to believe that their friendship with her made it impossible for them to be racist. Saira spent 4 decades upholding white supremacy to her own detriment, to the detriment of her family, to the detriment of all people of color. Besides your token friend or colleague of color, you have mostly surrounded yourself with other white people. They are your spouses, your neighbors, your kids' friends, your colleagues. You are cocooned by whiteness. When everything is white, you can focus on other characteristics, the things that make you different. How much time do white women spend talking about being blonde or brunette or a ginger? Us, we're just black and Asian. When everything is white, you enjoy the privilege of not being a monolith, of not being grouped together with other white people, because you are your own unique person. Your individuality enables you to separate yourself from bad white people, the real races, the ones wearing swastikas, MAGA hats, and white hoods. Yes, of course those people are horrific, violent white supremacists, but in your mind, they are not you. They are not even the same species as you. You would never use the N-word or call a bearded brown man a terrorist. You are different. You are good. You are a unique human. But us, we are a nameless, faceless, black and brown lump grouped together. Black people are criminals. Latinos are lazy. Muslims are terrorists. Asians are doormats. Your stereotypes of us are A, obviously not compliments, and B, meant to keep us down in our segmented groups and separate from each of those other segmented groups so that we aren't able to effectively organize against you. We are left fighting one another for the scraps that you, white folks, throw at us. We are a dark mass. We even look the same to you. You can't and won't be bothered to pronounce our names. Why bother to learn the name and face of the brown woman who serves you your favorite breakfast burrito every Tuesday? Why do Randall and Richard get so annoyed when you get them confused? They both are tall black men with beards in IT. Anyone would confuse them. But you? You are dirty blonde, whereas Beth is strawberry blonde. It's Catherine with a C, not a K. Your eyes are green, but turn blue when it rains. You are unique as fuck. And this is precisely how you manage to detach yourself from white supremacy in your mind. Your individuality has enabled you to create an us, good white people, versus them, bad, racist white people dichotomy that lets you off the hook. A, define racism in the narrowest possible way, burning crosses and epithets. B, white people are not a monolith. C, therefore, those of us white people not engaging in A are not racist. From A, B, and C, it's a short jump to D, dismissing people of color when they call out your racism, the racism of all white people, as angry, divisive, crazy, or our personal favorite, racist against white people. Your white cocoon, like a real cocoon, is seamless. You aren't even conscious of this line of logic. It just happens like breathing. You have created safe white spaces in every pocket of your life, your home, your neighborhood, your workplace, your kids' school, your college experience, your vacation. Safe white spaces that make it nearly impossible for you to see your complicity in the system that keeps Black, Indigenous, and Brown people in their places, which are beneath you. Sure, you've made quips and jokes, done things that could be considered microaggressions, but you're not racist. That digital blackface gif you send around from time to time, ribbing your Palestinian friend about being a terrorist, these are jokes. Can't people of color lighten up? Pun intended. Or what about finding your tribe or referring to your spirit animal? You're not racist. You're the least racist person you know, right? How could you be racist? But you are, and your quips and ribs are every bit as dangerous.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.